Can I follow you?
Yes. Unless you pick a day that I have a migraine.
How?
Been a while since I've seen you.
It has been. You're always busy.
Never ends for me, buddy.
Well, that's a good thing to keep busy. Keeps you out of trouble.
Most of the time.
On the way here, I was fiddling with my window mount so I could do like an in-car drive here, and I couldn't get it to work, so that's why I'm late. two whole minutes.
Yeah, I was gonna say, are you?
Well, usually I'm like,
everybody was late yesterday, except for one woman was 25 minutes early and she came at lunch.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I was like, hi. Just set the keys down. The only thing on the account now is the time on the drain infill. So just let me know. Do you want me to look it up or?
No, I'll. It's okay,
it's just
talking about the drum brakes.
Yeah, I don't think he's seen drum brakes yet.
No, I've seen drum brakes. Oh. I just thought, since one of the other ones, they have a little...
If I get a second before you put the tires on, I'll make it.
You could fit through there. That's one thing I love about my car. It fits anywhere.
I can put a truck through it.
Yeah.
Picked up another one. About that little blue Elantra.
For a flip?
I don't need it, so.
Is it a manual? Woo!
And it's only got like 180,000 on it, so still got life left.
It's a 2 liter, 1.8.
I want to say it's a 2 liter, but I could be wrong without popping it. But it's the touring model.
I like that. I love the wagon, like fastback thing.
And when I'm done with it, it's going to have all new brake lines, all new brakes all the way around, and a bunch of new suspension parts. It's one of Kevin's long, old customers from back in the Texaco days, and he doesn't drive, and he's got two cars, and the thing's been sitting. I was like, well, do you really want to put a couple grand in this? No. So what do you want to do? He goes, well, what's it worth for scrap? I was like, don't be ridiculous. You had me put a brand new clutch in this thing last year. So if that's what you're thinking, I'll give you what Scrapper wants and I'll take care of your bill.
Okay.
Because it's so light.
Hold on.
Sometimes I'll go 40 just for giggles.
Wet.
Wet?
Wet undercoating.
Oh, okay.
Nothing bad.
All right.
Wet where it's supposed to be wet. Trans too, right?
Yeah. Ooh, that's a little blacker than it was before. And I extended it. I went, what was it? I think it's almost 7K instead of the 6.
It's still not terrible. See how you can still see gold through there?
Yeah.
So it's not terrible.
But it's not as clear as it was the last time. Yeah. Is that because of winter conditions, maybe?
Fuel contamination, too.
Okay.
In the winter, we burn a lot more gas to get the motor running and stuff like that up to temp.
Right.
Most of the color in oil is fuel contamination.
Interesting.
Really, if you get bad stuff in your oil, it's too late.
Yeah.
Whatever it is broken.
Yeah. So longer oil change intervals are a bad idea.
Well, I thought that was a given.
Well, yeah. But it's amazing how many people will buy into that.
Well, but if you go by the manufacturer's recommended, you're also accepting the fact that that car is basically worn out at 100,000K or less.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Now, out of curiosity, when I was doing my own oil changes way back when, I would loosen the fill cap just to give it, just to take it
right
out. You take it right off?
Yeah. As the oil's coming out, if it doesn't suck in any air, it has to suck into the bottom.
Right.
Just like when you're pouring something and it goes glug, glug,
yeah,
glug.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
A lot easier if you do it an airway.
Yeah.
And then in my case, we're trying not to waste time, right? So the faster you're working from out, the better.
Right.
I'm terrible for doing my own oil changes on time. Because it's me and my cars, right? And I'll up and run for 10 minutes on the oil, shut them off, take out as hot as possible. You get away with that on some cars. Some cars you can't because just things are in the way and you're going to burn yourself. There's our drain hole. There's our fill hole. Nice. Go 32. Yeah. It's Captain on. Have you met him yet?
Briefly.
That's Kevin's grandson.
Yes. Briefly.
He used to be like so small.
How's Kevin doing, by the way?
He himself is doing okay.
Is that still dribbling away?
Oh yeah.
Wow.
Fridays anymore at all since he's recovered from cancer, because I finally made him, or he finally listened to me.
Us survivors tend to be stubborn.
Yeah, mechanics are bad. We're terrible. But also, we notice, like, when I go a weekend without doing something, I hurt on Monday.
Yeah.
Where if I spend all weekend cutting wood or fixing a car or whatever, on Monday morning, I'm primed and ready to go. So I also see the downside of sitting down for 3 days is probably a little bit harder, but he also needs a break. He needs the time to spend with Anita. Probably 14.
I notice you're not doing a topping or putting a little bit of oil in the filter before you put it in.
In the filter?
Yeah.
So there's two different things you could be talking about there. One is pre-oiling the O-ring.
Yes.
So that you get a nice slide.
Yes.
I put them on while the top is still wet.
Oh, okay.
So it's got lots. The other thing you could be thinking of is when you work on a diesel, you pre-fill the oil filter with oil before you put it on.
That's what I'm thinking
of,
yeah.
So it doesn't suck without a prime under your oil pump. Now, a diesel car or a diesel motor will be made so that the filter goes straight up. If you were to pre-fill an oil filter that goes on this way, you're going to dump it all as you're putting it on.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
So, pre-filling oil filters is something you worry about on diesels, maybe a race car. But then it'll have the oil filter purposely set up so that you can put it on full. Most cars you can't do that.
Right.
That's old school.
That's, yeah.
I haven't
that's,
heard anybody talk about something like that in a long time.
I remember doing that when I was, you know, in my Army days when I used to do, like, oil changes on the big trucks. They used
diesels,
to, exactly,
right?
They're all diesel.
Yeah, we used to be, like, bike guys used to be picky about it on their motorcycles, too. But
yeah, that's, yeah, I used to do it on my bike.
A lot of bikes have a cartridge oil filter in them, so you don't even have to worry about it, right?
Yeah.
But yeah, bike guys do tend to do it because you have such a small oil system, you don't want that moment of no oil.
Right.
These days, realistically, you change your oil, you're 10 steps ahead of everybody else. So.
Nice. Dirty tranny oil is not something you want. That's beautiful. In fact, if I had to guess, I'd say it's been done before.
This is the first since I got the car. So it's whatever the factory put in.
Well, you bought it brand new, eh?
Yeah, I bought it brand new.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it looks great.
Awesome. I'm glad it's not dirty. I've read
manual transmission fluid. If it gets dirty, it's because you've either overheated it or there's something wrong in your grinding.
I cringe when I read about people who have, you know, they bought their car and the car's got 150 plus K on it, whether it's kilometers or miles, and I've never changed a tranny fluid, and the car's not shifting right. I don't understand why.
See, and you know what's scary? Those people will come in and be like, hey, can I get a tranny fluid change? And you're like, oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Change your tranny fluid. Now you go for a test drive and it's shifting weird. And you're like, what is going on here?
Yeah.
And then they're like, oh, it didn't fix it? Well, whoa. Changing dirty fluid isn't going to fix anything. It's to prevent bad things from happening. If something's happening, it's already happened.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
GMs used to be bad for that in the 90s. People would come in with automatics and be like, oh, I need a tranny flush. You flush the tranny, take it out for a drive, and it starts shifting horribly. And then you find out, it happens so often that as techs, we got used to being like, if a random person came in and wanted a tranny flush, you go, why?
Yeah.
Are you having shifting problems? No, take it to the tranny shop. Like, I'm not touching your oil.
Yeah, yeah. One thing I did find is, I got the car in November 2021, and I found as the temperature started to drop, it's been that long, yeah. I did a 2-year review video a few months ago, and I'm doing this one because it's at 48K and the gear oil is being changed, so I thought, all right, well, let me do this, and that way I could talk to you and pick your brain and, you know, do what we do. One thing I found is the temperature dropped, it didn't shift as smoothly.
You mean external temperature? So the gear oil, right, is, think about it like maple syrup. You know,
exactly.
Really cold, it's harder to pour.
Exactly.
Oil works the same way.
Yeah.
And in manual transmission, usually have something like 75, 90 gear oil, something like that, versus say 530.
Yeah.
Right, or automatic transmission fluid that's super smooth.
Well, my original assumption was that whatever they're putting in at the factory just is, it does the job, but it's not that great.
Or it's just more sticky when it's cold out.
Yeah.
Now, on a manual gearbox, though, you want sticky because you want that oil to stay on the gear as it goes all the way around. Right? And then everything stays lubricated, even because you have an oil level and then you have gears.
Right.
So sticky isn't a bad thing. Now, if it gets to the point that you're like hard to shift, now, okay, we got something going on.
Right.
But a little stiffer is okay.
Well, the stick action wasn't stiff. It would just crunch going into gears.
Crunch?
Well, not crunch, but like going from well, when it was trying to, when you're, let's say, going into reverse, it would like
a little bit like
It would not only like be harder to put into that gear, like I'd have to force it, but it would also sometimes almost as if the synchros weren't meshing up and it would like.
Did you find it worse when you were starting it up, like when it was cold out? before the motor warmed up? Because your motor...
Yeah, as the motor warmed up, it got a little bit better, which yeah, so I just assumed... Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it'd be interesting to see if the redline fluid makes any difference.
Well, that's the other thing, is almost everybody said I put in redline and you don't notice the difference immediately. I'll wait for him to come back. I've known these guys for since 2014, so 10 years. In 2014, I bought my Mini Cooper.
Well, I'm glad I got you redline.
And... I bought my Mini Cooper and I didn't have a reliable mechanic, and everybody in the Mini Cooper local Cooper Club said, go to Kevin's Auto Care. Kevin himself, who is now, you know, almost 70 and had a cancer diagnosis, he's still alive, but he's recovering. And Gil, who I've been talking to since the start of this video, he's also a Mini owner and a Mini fanatic, and a fanatic when it comes to car care, and the guy's a savant, bordering on savant. So I'm really, really fortunate to have somebody like this to go to, because I want my cars to last a very long time.
Don't believe a word he says.
Don't believe the word I say. I'm just doing this for the sake of YouTube. It's all crap. Buy a car and never change any fluid.
Everybody's got an opinion.
Yep.
I know people that buy brand new, and as soon as the tires wear out, trade-in time.
Wow.
They never do anything. They never do any brakes. They never do nothing. They might do an oil change, and that's it. But to them, it doesn't matter, because they're just going to go get a new one.
And we wonder why our planet's being in the shape that it's in.
Yeah.
So that's okay. So that's the tranny fill.
That's the drain.
That's a drain hole.
Yeah.
You know, that's the other thing that amazes me about these cars is how simple they are. It reminds me of when I had a K car, like in the 80s, and I did everything myself.
I could feel the K car coming. No, manual transmissions are usually pretty simple. Because it is basically just a gearbox.
Yeah. Right?
There's nothing crazy about it.
Got her. Can you do me a quick favor? Can you take the seal off this? I wish it was that easy for me. I struggle with this. I was half expecting to tell you to go get a screwdriver.
Is it 32, right?
32, yeah. Never. another day.
Yeah.
Another long Friday for a break,
I think the wife's making a short one. She's got a headache. She wants to go home.
Oh. There she is.
There we go. So, the gearbox,
or with the diff, you almost overfill it on purpose.
Yeah.
And then you let it go until it's done dripping, and that's your full line.
So, there we go.
I was watching all the news clips yesterday about the big $15 billion deal with Honda and the EV plants in Alliston.
Well, okay, but see, now why are they doing that when they're talking about hydrogen?
That's my, I have to wonder myself.
What?
If EV is such a limited technology for so many people who don't have garages, who don't have a place to plug it in, and everybody's, even BMW's, they're abandoning EV, they're abandoning diesel, they're going hydrogen. Why is Honda doing this?
Yeah.
And why is the government involved? That's my big conspiracy theory. If the government's involved, it can't be good. Don't get you started.
The history of North America just shows, like, government involvement has never been good with anything. That's something.
And that's always been, ever since the government started offering rebates on EV purchases, there has been a thing going off in the back of my mind going, okay, yeah, we're saving money, but what's the real story here?
I'm just going to let that drip for a minute. I got to reset his tire.
All right. And while he's doing that, I'm going to show you. I'm going to show people Kevin's collection, well, mini collection. This is a... Mini R50 2006, I think. I had a 2006 when I first met these guys, and it was white, and I loved it. And every time I come in here for a fluid change, I ask them about this. I say, you know, what are you doing with it? What are you doing with it? Even though I know from experience that buying another Mini would not be kind to my pocketbook, it's one of those things where once you've had a Mini, you love them. There's nothing like them, and they always put a smile on your face. But it's sitting here collecting dust, and the last time I talked to Kevin, he said he would probably end up giving it to his grandson or selling it to his grandson. And then up there on the lift, that's a 454 SS Chevy. Beautiful, beautiful truck. The last time he was on the ground, he let me listen to the motor, and it was absolutely amazing. This is the kind of truck I'd like to have. Regular cab, short bed, just get in it and drive and let your hair down, so to speak, and just enjoy the breeze and the weather. Over here, well, there's tire storage for winter. And then over here is Gil's Civic that he drag raced at Luskville and actually did really, really well. I think he did not high eights or nines with this thing. It's a beast. Needless to say, he knows his stuff. Which is why I keep coming back. He does what needs to be done and nothing more. And it's, you know, your mom and pop shop. And that's the kind of places we need to support. Going to the dealer is great, but it's been said time and time again that the dealer doesn't always have your best interests at heart. Because they're running a business, and it's a big business, and their bottom line matters. With a mom-and-pop shop, yeah, they have a bottom line to consider as well, but they want to keep you as long-time customers. And the relationship means more to them than the bottom line. And that is where I like to spend my money. I remember Gil, a number of years ago, said... You know, when I was asking him about certain jobs that needed to be done, and I was on a budget. And the bottom line was, during that conversation, he said, our shop exists for people who want to keep their cars for a long time. If you're the type of person that trades in their cars every 3 years, go to the dealer, because they'll do what the manufacturer recommends and the bare minimum, and they know full well that they're going to sell you a new car in 3 years anyway, 3 or 4 years. So maintenance isn't a priority. Now, I am of the mind that I want to buy something and I want to take care of it and I want to last a long time. And in that respect, these guys and me have the same frame of mind. And shop local, support small business, support mom and pop shops. And I appreciate that part of the challenge is trying to find someone that you can trust and work with over the long term. That effort is, you know, it rewards, it'll pay you dividends and rewards, because cars are not cheap, they've never been cheap, and the longer you keep them, the more money you'll have in the bank, because as Zach and Andrea keep saying, the cheapest car is the one you own. So I'm looking forward to the point where I get a letter from Mitsubishi and they say that, congratulations, your car is paid off.
Are you still running the page, Mini?
I'm an admin. I check in from time to time.
Kind of weird, eh?
I've got, like, I guess that's one of the good things about the Facebook thing is now there was recently
100 guests.
I could automate, there was an automation for welcoming new members, so every Sunday at 1 p.m., it'll just mine whoever's joined in that week and then say, you know, let's welcome my new members, and I don't have to do anything.
Right.
There'll be the odd, I've got like Eric Stewart who's got moderation powers, so he'll help along with stuff. But it's, I mean, Mini owners are, well, they're pretty well behaved for the most part. And every time I see a Mini, well, geez, that car, in, you know, is an example. Every time I see one, I go, ah, you know what? So much fun owning one, and I'd love to get another one. And then I think of
the bills that I
didn't really like to have. But I don't know. Maybe one day again.
That little blue one outside's got a blown motor. Got really, really bad rod knock. First time that it cuts its own oil tank.
How do you blow that? Like an R? That's a Tri-Tech.
Yeah, extremely uncommon to have a mechanical failure like that on that motor, unless it's been started with oil.
Which is common for Minis, because the dealer says I only have to change it once a year. No.
It's on the floor. I don't know what it's for.
Give it to Ainsley. It's a core return key.
That's not a good one, I guess.
Seeing this bothers me. And yeah, that's my fault. Yeah, the lens is a little cracked there too. But you know what? It's plastic. It ain't gonna rust. You know how this happened? I'm pulling into a spot very slowly, and this guy, the driver, must have been, you know, talking to his passenger, and as I'm creeping into his spot, he opens his door. So
just straight shot at his door.
Yep.
Did it at least bend the lip of his door in a bit?
Nothing.
Aw.
Because I was crawling. Like, I was just crawling, because I kind of had a feeling, okay, well, he's pulled in just ahead of me, but he's not getting out of his car. Maybe he's, I don't know, waiting. So I'm crawling in anticipation of him opening his door. And he did what, like literally, like, flew it open. He must have been, I don't know what he was thinking, but we exchanged information. I looked at it and I was like, oh man. And I keep reminding myself that
it's in a parking lot. There's no lot to do about it.
Well, exactly. And I'm the one in motion. He was parked. So according to a lot of sources, I'm at fault because I'm the one in motion.
See, but if you open your car door when you're parked on the side of the road and you hit a person riding a bicycle, you're at fault for opening your door without checking.
Well,
so
that,
which way does it go?
I know. Well, that's what I was thinking. So the tire's going on, my summers are. '185 55 15s. The brand is DAI Die. The tires are Mirage. They're made in China. The model is MR162. And they have, I've had them on the car, bought them brand new, had them on the car one season. Very even wear, they're nice and quiet. They get me great gas mileage. They have a tread wear rating of, where is it? Oh, here we go. Okay, so tread wear 400, traction A, temperature A. So quality tire, and I think they cost me roughly $75 to $80 a tire, plus mounting, balancing, and then the rims were about $100 a piece. So what do we have? We've got Ineos 0W20 going in. Look how nice and golden brown that is.
good. It's so clean, I couldn't seal up.
That's good to hear. How often should the coolant be changed?
So every manufacturer is going to have a different recommendation. For instance, for quite a few years, General Motors had the Orange Dex coolant and everything, and that stuff was supposed to be lifetime.
Yeah.
And then eventually they started changing those stickers to change every 150,000 K.
Ah.
Or miles.
Right.
For me, I have to pick a general number because I get asked about so many different cars. So what I usually tell most people is, if you change all your fluids every 100,000, you're probably laughing. They might be recommended more often than that, especially because we live in Canada. You have to go to the extreme wear conditions. But then some of those will tell you to change your oil every 3,000. No one listens to
yeah,
that.
So. Yeah. So back in the day, you had a coolant strength gauge.
We used to test coolant strength, and then if it got too weak, you'd change it.
So that's no longer done?
You can. I still have a what the hell is it called? Hydro. Anyway, it tests the freezing point.
Well, yeah, in my mind, instead of doing that makes more sense than doing it at X number of kilometers. Because if your coolant strength is still good, why change it?
I think everything came back. Well, because there's other reasons for it too. It can become corrosive. It can actually build up voltage in the coolant as well.
Oh, but if the strength, I mean, wouldn't
strength
that be?
Strength and
wouldn't,
corrosiveness don't tend to work together.
Okay.
Because a coolant that's too strong will be extra corrosive.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, back in the day, we used to just fill it up with new coolant when we had something leak. I mean, you never really thought anything about it. But now you've got people going 10, 15 years without anything leaking.
Yeah.
So they had to start throwing in intervals.
Right.
Even me, myself, unless it's a car I've recently acquired, I don't worry about the coolant. If I'm changing something like a water pump or a rad, I drain everything and refill it with fresh stuff. And a lot of my clientele work that way because their cars are 20 years plus. And we are fixing rattles and rads and water pumps every couple of years, right? If you wanted to be extra picky about it, chop my interval in half. Change all your fluids up to 50,000. So, you want to spread it out a bit in case? Let's do a drain and fill on the rad before winter. There's not much else you could do on this. You could do a brake fluid flush, but your brake fluid looks beautiful. And I usually tend to wait until at least the first brake job to do a brake fluid flush.
Yeah.
Unless it's German, then every 2 years or you get a light. Your hubcaps are so tight.
Whenever they made the clips like holds more snugly, or the older ones were just not put on properly. But the number of times I've read that I lost a hubcap, these things don't stay on the car on the wheels properly.
Yeah, well, if they weren't put on properly to begin with.
And yeah, as you are struggling with this because they're so freaking. Whenever I do my own tire change. I struggle with it too.
Yeah, I don't think these ones are falling off anytime soon.
There's also some different things that can happen too, right? This metal ring holds these fingers tight. So let's say this is a 10-year-old hubcap and this metal ring's all rusted and bent and pried on, pried off.
Right.
It may not be fitting right. Now, this is a factory hubcap, so you only have one spot to put it. But a lot of aftermarket hubcaps will have two different spots. So you have a loose fit or a tight fit, depending on the style of rim you're putting it on. And if the person putting it together didn't take that into consideration, then hubcaps can fall off, right?
Interesting. I've learned something else, Dad.
You know, that being said, it is just plastic.
Yeah. 19. Screen? Yeah, I made that mistake when you got them for me. I should have got 21 because that's what the factory put on there. So now
do you
I'm,
have different wheel nuts for those rims?
No.
No.
Those are the ones that I got. And in hindsight, I should have asked for 21 when you got those for me. So now I'm carrying around an extra wrench just in case. I never thought of that. That is pretty hilarious.
How's it going, Padawan?
I've got
tested. Well, don't worry about mine. Finish this one, because he's waiting. Yeah.
I got this one. No worries.
Now you're marking those where they came off of.
Always.
In my
next year we're rotating.
Okay, so you wouldn't just measure tread depth and put the better ones up front.
No, because there can be an argument about that, actually. So old school mentality of thinking of it was to always put the tires with more tread onto the drive wheels. If you got a rear wheel drive with your rear tires, you got a front wheel drive with your front tires.
Okay.
Now that stopped somewhere around 2005-ish. The industry as a whole decided that the better tires should always go on the back. And the best simple example I can give for that is when you shoot an arrow, the feathers guide the back of the arrow, which keeps the arrow straight. If you have damaged feathers, the arrow doesn't shoot straight, right? It won't fly straight. In fact, if you have no feathers, it'll wonk all over. So the idea there is that if your front tires were to slip, you can regain control simply by letting off the brakes, right? But if your back starts to slide, there is no way to regain control on that, shy of being a really good driver.
Yeah.
And let's be realistic, 90% of drivers out there aren't capable of doing that. So it's to keep the rear of the car in control so you don't spin out.
Okay.
So you can have a difference of opinion, right? An old school car guy is going to be like, oh no, more meat should always go on the drive wheels. But then the guy that's worried about his grandmother's driving on the road, his clientele, he's going to do it the other way around. And then if your tires are so worn down that you're sliding more than you should be, it's time to replace them.
Yeah. Yeah.
So in this way, we just rotate them every season. And you hopefully get as even a wear pattern as possible.
These have been good.
And then you get into all-wheel drives. You get guys with full-size spares on their Toyota Tacoma or Toyota 4Runner, and they want a five-wheel rotation. I can do that because I can go left to right, right to left, back to front, but some of these kids, you would blow their minds adding a fifth tire to the puzzle.
Yeah, yeah.
Ready to roll? You ready to sticker? Write a sticker for me. A little more than half left on the front brakes.
It's not bad for 48, 49K.
Did I not take these off last year?
No, I did that.
Okay.
And that's why I was asking about tread depth.
Yeah, well, see, when they're not marked, now I have to look. All right, we got our front set up. They're not directional, right?
I don't think so.
Steel belted.
Nah.
Oh, you know what? We went to 19s because we got these rims.
Yeah, but 21s will fit there.
With a socket?
I'm pretty sure.
Close.
Oh, you know what? Maybe that's why.
That'd be damn close. A chrome socket will fit, but...
Ah, okay. That makes sense then.
I knew there had to be a reason. 5,000. Yeah.
Must be a treat lifting these compared to a big
Well, to be honest, since I got him working here, I don't lift anything big anymore. I can't chance it. If I end up hurting my back and my arms, then I'm down for all the cars.
Yeah.
So.
And the odds of Kevin coming in to pick up the slack are probably nil.
If I ask him to come out and help me, he's out here, but I have to ask.
You know, in all honesty, he's paid his dues. He deserves to put his feet up.
Oh God, yes.
And if I was a business owner, I'd probably have the same mindset.
And it's only like he's done that recently, and I've only been bugging him to do it for the last 10 years.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just glad he's finally taking Fridays off.
Now these have already been pumped up to 39 PSI, which is what they should be for this car. Sometimes I'll manually go up to 40 just because of that extra mileage that I get out of, like, the miles per gallon or liters per 100 liter per kilometer rating. I also find the car rolls a bit better with that extra 1 PSI, but splitting hairs really. I mean, 39 versus 40, I find even when I pump them up to 40, they end up going down to 39 or even 38 anyway.
Now, if I put 39 in on a day like today,
yeah,
when we're plus 25 out, we'll be 40.
That's true. Oh, okay, I stand corrected. They have not been pumped up yet. So we're going 39. I'd love to get one of those for my place.
Yeah, not for the price that I go.
Well, how much is one of those?
I
mean, I'm not talking about a...
It wouldn't surprise me if it's 200.
$200.
Wouldn't surprise me.
That's actually less than I expected.
Now, you can buy a Mastercraft one that will work just as good, especially if you're not using it 10 times a day, every day. My air pump in my car is a Mastercraft digital, so I set to the pressure I want, I turn it on, and then it shuts itself off when it gets there. It's beautiful.
That's what I'd like.
I think I got it on sale for like $25.
Wow.
If you take a raw tire valve, it'll fit perfectly into the inlet for an air mattress. So when we go camping, I just plug my air pump in to pump up my air mattress.
Just walk away, let it do its thing.
Set it to 5 PSI, walk away, come back. That's nice and firm, not overinflated. Okay, hold on. Before you do that, I'm gonna take this out. Can you bring this down and torque the wheels for me? Go, actually, I'm gonna look it up.
I can only imagine.
I just didn't want to put the dirt on your clean back.
That's the other thing I like about this car is that cloth, whatever material they're using is, God, so easy to keep. I thought I'd miss having leather, but I actually like this better. Serwin Vega.
Power. Is that a thin mount?
Yep.
Nice.
It's like, it's built to, built to withstand crap.
Nice. What does that go for? Is that amp too, or?
Yeah, that's a powered sub. So amp, so it's hooked into my Sony head unit.
Yep.
It's got sub out, so that goes there.
Yeah.
And
but that's the amp as well. That's all in one unit.
All in one unit.
That's neat.
And I think it was like less than $400, like $349-ish. I got it from Hyperion Tech on Bentley. They installed everything.
What? You didn't do it yourself?
Nah, I'm too old for that. Those days are long gone. Doing here is putting in the oil change interval sticker to remind me. Now he's resetting the wrench icon in the dash for oil change interval or service intervals.
still got 11,000 left on the counter, so I'm just gonna leave it.
All right. That's a good looking set of wheels. Oh, now he's going around the block to make sure that everything works okay. There's the Mini that he was talking about with a blown motor. Tale of caution. Change oil, people. Oil starvation is never a good thing. This is similar to what I had before. The one I had before was red and it was a convertible, but oh God, what a fun car. Yeah, fun car, but I do not miss the repair bills. Every time they would be in for service or something or other, every 3 months, and every time it was in for something, something needed doing, $1,000 later,